Coming up in the news tonight, the nation's leader, Prime Minister, the Most Honorable Dr. Hubert Minnis, was sworn in today as Minister of Finance. A major reconstruction project underway in the East Grand Bahama community. And the Ministry of Tourism giving back to taxi drivers on Grand Bahama. The Bahamas Tonight, the Northern Edition, starts now.
This is the Bahamas Tonight, Northern Edition.
This is the Bahamas Tonight, the Northern Edition. Good evening, I'm Natalia Hall. Thank you so much for tuning in. Topping the news tonight, the nation's leader, Prime Minister, the Most Honorable Dr. Hubert Minnis, was sworn in today as Minister of Finance by the Governor General during a brief ceremony in the nation's capital. The swearing-in ceremony comes following the resignation of Member of Parliament for East Grand Bahama, Peter Turnquest, as Minister of Finance and Deputy Prime Minister last week, who stepped down from his post amidst allegations of fraud. The Prime Minister says the country should know as early as this week as to who will serve as the new Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Finance. In other news, a major reconstruction project underway in the East Grand Bahama community. Last September, Hurricane Dorian ravaged settlements in the east, destroying homes, the docks, the police station, clinic, administrative office, among many other public and private entities. The Minister for Grand Bahama and Member of Parliament for the area, along with other government officials, were taken on a tour of the area today. Shashina Rolf-Arkison reports.
The walkthrough taking place to assess the progress and work underway in the East End Reconstruction Project. The renovations include the clinic, police station, the dock and administrative office. Minister of State for Grand Bahama, Kwesi Thompson, says this is proof that East End is not forgotten and the work continues. The Member of Parliament for the area, K. Peter Turnquest, also noting that he is pleased with the level of work taking place.
It is a complete renovation, a new roof. All of the inside has been gutted out and all of the inside has been completed and renovated.
This area, including the administrative building, is a high traffic area because it does serve as the gateway to Abaco from the eastern end in particular, and as well as all of the fishing traffic and activity that happens here. And so this is an area that was particularly in need of repair so that it's more convenient and safer for its users. We're looking forward to getting the police back in the community, in the police station, because again, there's so much movement of people that it requires constant monitoring.
Another area completely compromised as a result of Hurricane Dorian was the seawall, which is also part of the roadwork reconstruction project for some $6 million. Minister of State for Disaster and Reconstruction Authority Aaron Lewis says all of the work is under the Build Back Better initiative, which means building back better and safer. Contractor and Vice President of WA Construction Brian Waugh says the seawall took about 3 weeks to complete.
We are on a slope called a revetment. As you would see to my left, what was is now in the water, but WA Construction came back and we built it in a more resilient manner. This is more than just a seawall, this is the defense wall that will protect the community of McLeanstown. Again, as a part of the Build Back Better initiative. The protective wall over there again, that is solid, which will allow it to stand up more against wave action. And the revetment again is slope deliberately to allow the backswash not to have a lot of effect with respect to washout.
We also built a section of wall here that was solid poured and a small bit of sidewalk.
And for the first time, a new road, 450 feet, is being built in the Rocky Creek community.
In this community, we have everybody from children to elderly folk. Some people who have special needs, some children that have special needs. And so this is certainly going to make it much more comfortable for them. We're going to be rebuilding the bus shelter For the kids so that they can wait in comfort for the bus to take them down into Freeport or to High Rock to school. And so hopefully we'll have that up shortly.
Because as you see in the background to my right, we have the power poles, more heavy duty power poles. We have the heavy duty power lines, and we also have street lights, I believe, in the community for the first time. So beyond building back better, we also building back safer.
The entrance to Pelican Point is also an area that is being rebuilt. The street was described as one of the most dangerous curves on the island.
But as far as the road work is concerned, this is, again, as I say, critical work. You'll notice to the north of us, there's a causeway that connects this part to the main Grand Bahama Highway down the way that also needs some shoring up. And I'm sure that the Ministry of Works, once we get past this, we'll work on that.
These ministers give this credit for the work taking place in East Grand Bahama.
Throughout the course of after post-Dorian, he has been one of the strongest advocates of the East End community and ensuring that East End really gets its due in terms of the rebuilding effort.
And as Minister for Grand Bahama said, the Member of Parliament has been a strong advocate, and I'm happy to see that all of his efforts are now being realized.
Shashina Rule Farkason, ZNS Network News.
Thanks, Shashina. While the Ministry of Health confirming 13 new cases of COVID-19 yesterday, those new cases bringing the country's total of confirmed cases to 7,530. Of those 13 new cases, 5 are in New Providence, 6 in Grand Bahama, and 2 with locations pending. A total of 20 cases are hospitalized. 7 of those cases are in hospital on Grand Bahama. There were no reported recoveries, and the death toll remains at 163. While principal of the Jack A. Whitta Senior High School, Bronwyn Smith, shutting down rumors that a student at that institution may have tested positive for COVID-19. She says that a parent of a student was being investigated by the COVID-19 health team, and as a result, persons who were around that student were asked to quarantine. And since then, the school has received some updated information.
Today, we had a meeting with the COVID-19 team and Dr. Bartlett, and he was able to inform us of the truth, and that is that we have no COVID-19 positive case at this school. Unfortunately, bad news travels much quickly than good news. But of course, we are very happy about that good news. I want to communicate to the parents that you might have been concerned, but a lot of that was rumor. And the truth is that we are COVID-19 positive free, and we still depend on their cooperation and their support to ensure that we will stay that way. And so school is going to be resuming in full force tomorrow, so please send your children out full uniform. Please remind them of the protocols that they must follow, and continue to talk to them about that at home, because we need all of the support that we can in order to remain COVID-19 free.
Now the principal confirming that several teachers called in sick today.
I believe that, persons, I suppose, are very, very concerned when they hear that the majority of their administration team is on quarantine. And perhaps it was human nature that, you know, they're upset and disturbed and figure that they must stand aside. But we're all in this together, and that's why the truth must prevail. And we must always be thinking about what can we do to make things better and to support each other and to encourage each other. And so that's where we're at now. We are also looking at even ways that we can improve our protocols to make it even safer in this environment. We know we've been doing this for months, and we have been doing a very good job. And so, we're just about getting into examination times, and I want us to get back on track.
While public school students returned to the classrooms last month after the COVID-19 pandemic delayed the reopening of schools across the country, 1 month later, and Ministry of Education District Superintendent for Grand Bahama, Bimini, and the Keys, Ivan Butler, has his update.
In Grand Bahama, as you may know, we've engaged in a face-to-face program in all our schools, and this served our community of Grand Bahama very well. Nassau was doing the virtual program, and so We were very pleased with the way this term went. We had several incidents, but they were taken care of with the help of the COVID task force. And so we are very, very pleased with the way that our term went this far.
Butler says they are looking forward to engaging in a more face-to-face learning in the new year.
We are thankful for those parents who work with us and continue to work with us for keeping our children safe. Our schools are safe zones. We do everything in our power to keep our schools safe. And so we just want to assure the parents that it's okay to send their children to school because it is safe. And we are very pleased with the face-to-face operation of our school. Our students were out of school for a very long time last year. And so the face-to-face operation is very, very rewarding for our students and teachers this year.
Meanwhile, a group of Grand Bahama residents are speaking out on a number of issues affecting the island and the wider Bahamas. Jamila Mizik has the details.
A group of demonstrators coming together to address what they say are several pressing concerns. Kendall KCX Colebrook of the Enough Movement says they want to see the Hawksbill Creek Agreement removed.
Can you imagine an agreement made where it was supposed to be 3 years for mining this harbor in Freeport, Grand Bahama? 3 years. Please read the document. It's the Hawksbill Creek Agreement. 3 years from 1955. And all of a sudden now it's 2020, and guess what? We haven't made one penny. They've made trillions of dollars since then, but the Bahamian people has not made one penny. This contract, this Hawksbill Creek Agreement, which is a failed agreement, will not be honored anymore in Grand Bahama. No. Grand Bahama and the Hawksbill Creek Agreement is a failed experiment. And we're asking for it to be removed.
Harold Roberts of Freedom Wealth Alliance says they intend to unite to fight for the future generation's right to natural resources.
The ground upon which we stand is our own. The resources in those grounds are our own. The aragonite, the carbonite, all ours. But other people are saying is their own. No, sir. These are ours that we will pass to the generations to come. Our children and their children.
Demonstrator Stephen Hall says they also have questions about value-added tax.
Where is this money going? Where is this money going? That is the question that the people of Grand Bahama came to ask today. Where is the VAT money going? The VAT was introduced to ease the burdens of Bahamian people, not to keep them stagnated in the process of a downward spiral that we're in now. Where is the money going? I urge the government to seek the appropriate, or we caution them to stand up and make these statements known.
And Pastor Ricardo Davis is asking for greater public support in their fight.
We need to support and back these brothers in the fight that they are embarking upon, because you look at Casey, you look at Brother Bain, you look at many other the brothers, them, we don't really need this. You understand? And so we are fighting for success, for our successive generation and the generation to come. And so we need all hands on deck, because this must stop. This must stop, and it must come to head, and the people of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas must benefit of our natural resources.
Change is not coming! Change is here!
Jamila Mizik, ZNS Network News.
In other news, 11 Haitian migrants apprehended in Grand Bahama yesterday, according to reports. Officers of the Immigration Department, assisted by officers of the Royal Bahamas Police Force, acting on information received, arrested and detained 11 Haitian migrants. The group, consisting of 9 adult males and 2 adult females, were found on board a vessel 18 miles east of Lucayan Harbor. The migrants, along with 1 Bahamian male, were brought to shore for further processing and screening by Ministry of Health personnel.
Thank you, because you didn't have to.